My name is Diana Karpenko, and I'm a community building expert and co-founder of Oborog Arts Village in Ukraine, where I was organizing dozens of cultural events in the last 15 years. Also, I have experience of organizing art projects in some other places in Ukraine and in other countries as well. I visited 35 countries and researching different cultures and presenting Ukrainian culture abroad have always been my passion. Since the war started in Ukraine, I moved to Poland, and in the last few months, I was involved in a project where I was working with temporary displaced persons from Ukraine and Polish volunteers. Therefore, today, I want to share with you my own observation about the cultural differences between our peoples to help to prevent possible conflicts and misunderstanding. During preparation of this webinar, I interviewed a dozen of Ukrainians who recently found themselves in Poland due to Russian invasion, as well as Ukrainians who have been living in Poland for a long time. I also talked to Poles who are working now with temporary displaced people from Ukraine or who host Ukrainians in their homes. So the information that I will share with you is not only my subjective opinion. I would like to demonstrate to you the general conclusions of my research. So, who are Ukrainians? Perhaps the Poles could form a certain stereotype about the Ukrainians, most of whom came to Poland in earlier years to work. First of all, I would like to mention that now, to Poland came representatives of very different fields of activity. A lot of them are people who had a good career or business in Ukraine, teachers, the creative class. Most of them didn't plan to immigrate and had a fairly good quality of life at home. Also, you should be aware of the differences between different generations. Sometimes, if you communicate with a young person from a big city and with an older person from a small village, you may feel like these are people from different countries because of their habits, mindset, and behavior in many cases could be totally different. Young people, for the most part, are very active, creative, business-oriented, highly educated. They travel a lot and can speak a few languages. They can adapt easily. They are not afraid to look for a new job, learn a new language, and they can easily communicate with new people. At the same time, the older generation, whose youth fell on the Soviet or post-Soviet times, are more closed, and for them, a change of residence, and especially a new country, is much more stressful. In fact, Ukraine is a huge country, the biggest in Europe. That's why Ukrainians really have regional differences. A lot of people who were now forced to leave their homes because of the war didn't have the experience of traveling not only abroad, but didn't even travel much within the borders of Ukraine. So I just want you to be aware that personal background really matters. And this, of course, affects perception of willingness or unwillingness of the person to adapt. And this is also a reason why it's quite difficult to talk about Ukrainians in general, but I will try to outline the common characteristics and explain some details that differ. So let's start from some similar things. For Ukrainians as well as for Poles, family values are very important. Then language. Ukrainian and Polish, the Slavic languages, have many common traits. Wikipedia says that about 70% of the vocabulary of both languages is the same, but I have come across data about even more than 80%. This suggests that Polish is lexically much closer to Ukrainian than Russian, for example. About what I have seen in practice, Ukrainians understand Polish quite easily if you speak to them slowly and pronounce words clearly. And in a few weeks, they already understand 70 or 80% of what you're talking about. For example, my children understand, I guess, 95% of Polish words in a few months at Polish school. So, from my experience, people who have already been living in Poland for several months could understand Polish language quite well. Poles understand Ukrainian a little less, but in the same way, if I speak slowly and clearly pronounce the words, the main meaning of the sentences can be understood. There is a thing you have to be aware of. You have to be aware of if there is a truth that there are a lot of Ukrainians who are still speaking Russian, but now this issue became more acute, and a lot of people have a very negative reaction to the Russian language. So la Russian language could be a huge trigger for Ukrainian speaking people. So even if you speak Russian, don't try to start the conversation on Russian. First, ask if it's okay to the person or not. Then, cuisine. Among the young people, now there is a new trend for the healthy food. You can often meet vegetarians or vegans, but I think it's quite similar as in Poland. And if we talk about the traditional cuisine and food habits, they are also quite similar with Polish. We have many similar dishes like pierogi, which we call vareniki in Ukraine, or buckwheat is quite popular in both countries. Potatoes in various conditions, soups and salads recipes are also quite similar, and of course, different variations of cooking meats. We also have some differences in our cuisines that can sometimes create curious situations. Probably everyone already knows that Ukrainian borscht and Polish borscht are different dishes. Yeah, and I personally had a curious situation in the place where I had accommodation the first days in my stay in Poland, of my stay in Poland. The host bought us some food and left it in the fridge as a gesture of hospitality. And among other products, there was a package with liquid. It looked like a juice pack, but there was written on it the soup. I was surprised because we don't have such packages with the soup. But I was even more surprised when I tasted that soup. It was very sour, and I thought it had just expired. And only a month later, when other Poles treat me to Żurek, I realized that it was a liquid for Żurek and not an expired soup. So, yeah, the main key to avoid misunderstanding in communication is communication. And here we really have some differences in the way we communicate. There was a research made by Erin Meyer based on her work at the Business School for the World in Paris, and it provides a field-tested model for decoding how cultural differences impact international business. In her book, Cultural Map, written on the basis of this research, she also compares how Poles and Ukrainians communicate. She talks about such a concept as high context and low context communication. High context communication means that the message is conveyed by hints and never expressed directly. And low context communication means that everything is expressed and understood literally. Yes means yes, and no means no. What does it mean in practice? When you talk with Ukrainians, in most cases, listen to the intonations and be sure to ask what they really meant and how they understood you. Sometimes It's a really good idea to ask additional questions to clarify, did you understand the person right? There is also a good example in our languages with the word maybe, with the word napewno. Yeah, in Polish word napewno means for sure, 100%. And in Ukrainian language, this word means maybe. In Ukrainian, you can hear quite often such a word construction like tak napevno or ni napevno, which means yes, maybe, or no, maybe. So, what does it mean finally? Yeah, like maybe yes, maybe no, maybe rain, maybe snow. So, in the situation when Poles can tell directly what is the problem, Ukrainians listen to intonations. They are trying to understand hints. They can really expect that their thoughts could be read, and sometimes they can wait when you will understand what's going on just from their facial expression. Therefore, when you communicate with Ukrainians, it's better to clarify what they meant and try to specify a question. Both speak directly and more specifically. So you are really very good in it. I would also say that Poles are a little calmer and more relaxed, and Ukrainians may seem too emotional or even too demanding for Poles. I often hear the phrase from Poles like, take it easy, yeah, spoko, spokojnie. It also affects behavior. Therefore, for them, like for Poles, Ukrainians can appear impatient. This applies especially for the service sector. In the last few years, the service sector in Ukraine has become highly digitalized. For example, you can open a bank account and get a plastic card in 15-20 minutes right in the bank office and don't have to wait to receive the bank card by post, as it is in Poland. We also have an online bank that doesn't have any office, similar to British bank Revolut. You can open an account in the online application and pay with this online card on the same day. And the online support service of most popular banks in Ukraine works 24/7, and you can find out any question even when the official working hours have ended. The same with the medical field. Ukraine had the system called Helsi, thanks to which you can make an appointment with a doctor online. No need to call, and if your need is urgent, you can very quickly find the necessary specialist and get an appointment on the same day. In Poland, I encountered the fact that you have to make an appointment with most doctors in advance. You have to call, which is quite difficult when you have a language barrier, and then wait several days for an appointment. The same goes to the bureaucratic system. Many issues related to the preparation of documents in Ukraine can be resolved online. You can even open and close a small company online and don't have to stay to stand in lines. In the morning, the person can came up with an idea for a startup, and in the evening, he or she already can start to implement it. As a result, you may face a situation where some Ukrainians may seem impatient and demanding because Ukrainians get used to something being done in a few hours, but in Poland they have to wait for the same service for a couple of days. Shops also are open on Sundays and close later. Before the war in big cities, many shops were open 24/7. Before, it was possible to buy groceries or order food delivery from some restaurants or even buy flowers in the middle of the night. This is also affects planning. For example, in Ukraine, I never planned grocery shopping because I know that I could go to a store any day, anytime, and buy what I needed. Now in Poland, I have to plan free Saturday to buy groceries for the week because I won't have the opportunity on Sunday. This is in turn affects planning in general. Ukrainians plan less. They are more spontaneous and more flexible, even in business. It also affects working hours. Ukrainians often work on weekends. This applies to many spheres. Poles have more respect for business hours and follow the working culture more. Therefore, if you cooperate with Ukrainians, do not forget to communicate about your working hours. If you don't want to receive work calls or emails after 6 p.m. or on weekends. For Ukrainians, the time is flexible, when for Poles, it's linear. Poles are more inclined to a linear approach to time. They value following the schedule and accuracy. Ukrainians value flexibility more than accuracy. So here is a tip. Be prepared that plans will often change, delays or postponements are inevitable. It might be a good idea to ask about the plans from time to time and adjust them accordingly. This is also applies to hours of reduced noise. Officially, we also have this rule, but not so many people follow it. In general, there is a habit of not following the rules that much. I would also say that Ukrainians are a little louder and have a smaller distance between themselves. The culture of keeping boundaries with another person is just on the very beginning in our country. So Ukrainians can talk quite loudly on the phone in a public transport, for example. With there to turn on the music at full volume in the car or in some public places, for example, on the beach. So if such a situation annoys or disturbs you, please just try to remember that they are not aware that they invade other people's space by their loud music or conversation. So they don't want to get on your nerves. They just need a reminder to keep it down. You could also observe that Ukrainian mothers can talk more loudly with their children. For example, I observe such situations in playgrounds quite often. It's rare than that a Polish mother shouts on her children or makes loud remarks to them. And Ukrainian mothers quite often communicate in this way with their children. In my opinion, this is a consequence of the post-Soviet culture of upbringing, what is called in Poland as Russian school. Yeah. We are gradually moving away from this, but some habits still remains. Also, I would like to add here that you should not be in a hurry to condemn the Ukrainian mother and make remarks to her that she does not communicate very correctly with her child. Consider that Ukrainian mothers are under a lot of stress right now. Being with a child abroad in war immigration is very difficult. At home, most of them have help from the children's father, grandparents, or babysitters. Here now, most mothers are forced to take care of children themselves, and in the same time, they should solve many other routine issues related to housing, job searching, plus daily disappointing news from Ukraine. The lack of a familiar circle of communication, both for the mother and for the child. All this adds tension. Mothers are extremely stressed. And every single small incident like ripped clothes or a small injury can result in a huge difficulty buying new clothes or dealing with foreign health system. Therefore, sometimes the situation when the mother communicates too loudly and too emotionally with the child may not be related to a behavioral characteristic, but just to a higher level of stress. Returning to the topic of rules. In Ukraine, people do not generally obey rules. I wouldn't say that Poles follow the rules very strictly compared to Austrians or Danes, for example. But nevertheless, compared to Ukrainians, Poles follow the rules more strictly. This especially applies to driving rules. In Poland, people follow the rule that pedestrians always have a right of way. And this is expressed in the culture of behavior in such a way that when crossing the road where there is no traffic light, pedestrians often do not even look to see if cars stopping because they expect by default that the driver should see them and stop. In Ukraine, this rule works really badly, and the pedestrian must first make sure that the driver has seen him and stopped, and only then cross the road. I recently took a taxi in Warsaw, and the driver was Ukrainian. And all the way, he complained that the Poles were not looking if he stopped or not before the crossing, and said that they are too safe. The same with parking. Unfortunately, in Ukraine, parking is very chaotic. People park on the sidewalk, pedestrian crosswalk, etc. The penalty system doesn't work perfectly. Therefore, if you know Ukrainians who came to Poland in their own car, explain to them how to park in how the parking rules and fines work here so that they avoid trouble. And if you host Ukrainians in your home, it's also a good idea to announce the rules, including the hours of reduced noise or a garbage sorting if you do. In Ukraine, garbage sorting is a fairly new trend, and although some rules already exist at the state level, but in practice they still work very poorly. Therefore, most Ukrainians do not have the habits of sorting garbage. So far, only activists and very conscious people do it. So it's worth explaining how it works in Poland. I know that here also not everything is perfect with this, but still better than in Ukraine. Also, to avoid misunderstanding, voice how you use the heating system and water in your house. In Ukraine, the majority of multi-apartment building that were built during the Soviet time have a central heating system, so people do not have the habit to controlling the heating in apartments. Also, the price of electricity and water is quite low compared to prices in other European countries, so people are not aware of how much water and electricity they use. So, if it's important to you, again, you should voice and make sure that the person understands you correctly. Heating, water, and gas meters, and garbage sorting needs to be explained. I would also like to mention some psychological aspects you should have paid attention for in communication with Ukrainians who moved to Poland because of the war. You don't know the background, and you shouldn't judge a person just because the person came from the west of Ukraine or their home was not damaged. Remember that there is no completely safe place in Ukraine now, and missile attacks have already taken place in almost all regions of Ukraine. Therefore, when somebody asks me, "Is your house still standing?" I really feel uncomfortable, and I hear this from many people. So usually I answer, "Yes, fortunately, it hasn't been destroyed so far." But no one knows what can happen tomorrow because war is not stopping. And this is not really a war of only armies. What Russia is doing is genocide and terrorism, and any day there can be a missile attack anywhere. So please try to avoid such questions as, "Is your house still standing?" I have also heard stories when people are refused to rent apartments if they came from territories that are not occupied. One of my friends from Kiev was told that we are ready to provide housing only for people from Mariupol or other occupied territories. People could think also that Ukrainians who left in the very first days of the war and didn't really experience the war firsthand, didn't escape the occupied territories, didn't lose their houses, and didn't experience bombing and shelling, are okay. But you just have to know that many people have relatives or friends in the army or in the occupied territories. During this time, almost every Ukrainian has a friend who has already been killed in this war. So, if not all were physically affected, then the absolute majority was psychologically affected. There is no one Ukrainian who has not suffered from the Russian invasion. In this case, try to avoid also such questions as, "Is your family safe?" Because you never know the story and what can happen after this question. Yeah, so better to ask, "Do you have contact with your family?" And as I mentioned at the beginning, many people lost their careers or businesses, they lost their normal life. I understand that some requests may seem strange to you, but do not rush to judge. When a person asks for advice on where to make a manicure or which coffee shop has a good coffee, please do not think that people are not grateful or rude. If they're asking for something that you consider a luxury, this could be just their way to go back to normal life. Remember that we are running away from war, not from poverty. And such things could help to gain psychological comfort. One more thing about demanding. As I said earlier, it's easy to open a small business in Ukraine. By the age of 30, people can already have two degrees, try several small businesses. In Ukraine, the economic situation was not very stable even before the war, and it stimulates people to be proactive, more creative, and flexible, to work overtime in order to keep afloat. And that is why young Ukrainians who have now come to Poland are often looking not for any job, but for a good, well-paid job, which can also cause irritation. After all, there is a stereotype that refugees should be satisfied with what they are given. And one more thing about the older generation, which I encountered in my own work with temporarily displaced person from Ukraine. The space in which I worked was organized in such a way that everybody could serve himself. Usually, when a person came for the first time, the volunteers showed everything, where you can make a coffee or tea, where there was cookies, where we also organized hot lunches, and our visitors could take as much food as they needed and then wash their dish themselves. So for people like to feel more convenience and possibility to serve themselves, we have signed all the cabinets where are cups, plates, spoons, and so on. But there was one older lady who was coming quite often and always expected to be served coffee. Volunteers were often busy with other things, so she asked other visitors to make her coffee or the organization's employees. And it looked as if she had come to a cafe and was waiting for service. I also heard similar stories from other volunteers from other organizations when older people expected special treatment. And here we are dealing not with arrogance, but indeed with the cultural peculiarity. The older people grew up in a fairly patriarchal culture, and they have this belief that younger people want them something. So that they are simply used to the way it should be like this, and it's difficult for them to adapt for new circumstances and change their habits and behavior. Therefore, if it seems to you that a person is too demanding, try to ask and specify the need instead of becoming irritated. You don't know this the history, the story, what happened to the person, what state of mind they are in. And of course, remember the main rule of volunteering. You don't have to help to the point when you yourself would need help. This is really very important. If you like to keep your house in order, or you have no experience living with children, hosting a family with kids may be too difficult for you. You don't have to sacrifice your life. It's better to avoid the situations when you overtax yourself or do more than what is comfortable for you. If you burn out quickly, you still won't be able to help. Therefore, save your resources, and then you will be able to be useful to people for a longer time. Also, be sure to tell people at the beginning how long you are ready to provide them with accommodation or any other assistance. So, if we would talk about support, to support people during a traumatic experience is not is to make sure that they got emotional, social, and economical support, that they feel safe. To make them feel safe, we need to act adequately. Give people a choice and don't put pressure on them. Don't help them by force. If possible, give people a separate room and leave them alone. They really need a safe, private place now. And please do not insist on shared meals, walks, and any activities. How to communicate with people who have been traumatized? In Poland, as well as in Ukraine, the culture of small talk is not very developed. Therefore, when you ask a person, how are you doing? Be ready to listen the whole story of her or his life. Some stories can be very difficult. If you're ready to listen to them and give the person support and empathize, it's okay. If not, it's better to avoid such questions as why are you sad or why are you happy or how are you? Better to ask what do you need now or how can I help you? What helps you to get through this? And please don't cry looking at people. These people already feel so shitty. They cannot feel responsible for your tears and your emotions, but it's possible to mirror their cry and give them acceptance and sympathy. And the last but not least, about the gratitude. An important rule: if you decide to help, do not expect gratitude. I know of situations where people was hosted and then when they left, they didn't say even thank you for the hosters. I understand that it's unpleasant. There are also situations when people simply do not have the resources for it and they don't pay attention for this because they are extremely stressed. For example, I cannot even remember the names of everyone who helped me in the first days in Poland. So, yeah, you also need to understand that people are very different and in very different psychological states. Therefore, help exactly as much as you can and do not expect gratitude. This will help you not to be disappointed and not to burn out emotionally. And remember the really important thing that Ukrainians are really grateful for Poles for all the help you provide us. And as Ukrainian ambassador in Poland, Andrzej Deshica, said, they told us that we have an older brother, but history shown that in reality we have a warm-hearted sister, Poland. And it's true. Thank you for your attention and take care.